lead-off presentation is by John Hoefle, Real Economy versus Virtual Economy versus Real Psychosis. Unless you're about to have a virtual psychosis. Virtual reality, real psychosis. Anyway, John.
Alan Greenspan walks into a bar. He orders an expensive glass of champagne and some pretzels. The next morning, the New York Times carries the banner headline, Greenspan expects economy to expand with some twists and turns. Greenspan is, after all, sorry, Lynn, but Greenspan is the financial genius of our times. His every utterance is studied for hidden meanings, secret codes. My favorite method is to take the Washington Post coverage of his speeches, cut it up into tiny little strips, and read it like tea leaves. Look at Greenspan's amazing record. When he was sworn in as chairman of the Federal Reserve in 1987, the Dow Jones Industrial Average was just at 2,700 points. Today, it's over 11,000 points. Slide. Okay. So the Dow has nearly doubled since he warned of irrational exuberance. God only knows where it would be today were he not so successful in keeping it under control. Under Greenspan, the U.S. economy has become the envy of financial parasites all over the world. We have a derivatives market second to none, a stock market well beyond reason, debt levels that make the bankers drool, and enough jobs so that everybody can have two or three. Greenspan may not be able to walk on water, but he has certainly shown that he can run right over the edge of the cliff without falling. But the Fed chairman hasn't done this all by himself. He's had plenty of help from some of the brightest minds in the business, including the rocket scientist on Wall Street who figured out that you could sell enormous amounts of derivatives issued by bankrupt banks and backed by worthless paper. Take Robert Merton and Myron Scholes, who won the Nobel Prize in Economics for nearly blowing up the global financial system. This pair won the prize in 1997 for developing a new method to determine the value of derivatives. Here's an example of their work. What gobbledygook. At the time they won the prize, Merton and Scholes were partners in long-term capital management, the big hedge fund that, using their formula, managed to turn millions of dollars in capital into billions of dollars in losses on trillions of dollars in derivatives bets. It lost so much money that the Federal Reserve and the banks had to step in and bail it out, lest it default on its derivatives and set off a chain reaction of derivatives defaults that could have wiped out nearly every major bank in the world. This prize-winning nonsense is arguably the worst betting system ever devised. Now that's not so surprising given the track record of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, which awards the Nobel Prize. In the past, they've awarded the prize to defenders of slavery and feudalism. If they were honest, they'd revoke all the economics prizes they've awarded in the past, except for the one given to Maurice Allais, and give one to Lyndon LaRouche. But the oligarchs of the Royal Academy are not trying to spread the truth, but to hide it. We live in a world gone nuts, where fiction is pretty strange, and truth is stranger still. Take the following truism, which you can find in the business pages of virtually any major newspaper at least once a year. In a free market, the true value of assets is accurately established by the actions of investors. If an asset is overvalued, investors will stay away, causing the price to drop. If an asset is undervalued, investors will buy, causing the price to rise. Now, the only problem with that statement is that none of it is true. None of it. Free market? What free market? It doesn't exist. The markets are largely the creation of an international financial oligarchy, which uses them as a battering ram against the nation state and a way to pick people's pockets. The oligarchs routinely organize raids on nations as a way of bailing out their banks. The European currency crisis of 1992 pumped billions of dollars of revenue into the bankrupt U.S. banks. And it made George Soros his reputation as the man who broke the pound. But then, as now, Soros is a front man, a nasty one to be sure, but merely a front man for something larger and more evil. The so-called Asian crisis of 1997 was another banker's manipulation, as was the central bank intervention of 1998 and the intervention underway today. It's insider trading on a scale that would make Ivan Boesky turn green with envy. Free? Only in the sense that the oligarchs are free to steal. Investors? What investors? Virtually all of what is called investing today is really speculation, bets on the movements of stocks, bonds, and currencies. Investors are people who put money into an enterprise in order to increase its usefulness to society. But the markets today are a giant casino where gamblers place bets that some things will rise and others will fall. And since this casino is rigged, the advantage goes to the insiders. So you can call them thieves and suckers, but not investors. True value of assets? Well, you've got to be kidding. The real economy of the United States, the physical economy, is measured in terms of physical inputs, outputs per capita, per household, and per square kilometer, has fallen by some 50% since the late 1960s. Now, the Dow back then was hovering at just under 1,000 points, which means that according to the economic fundamentals, it should be about 500 points today. Of course, that doesn't count inflation, the looting of foreign countries, and the cannibalization of what was once the most powerful industrial economy in history. But still, anyone who claims that today's bubble reflects the true value of assets is a damn fool. Now, the Wall Street Journal recently ran an op-ed which claimed that the internet was more important to the economy than the Federal Reserve. Now, in a sense, that's true, because at least there are some useful aspects to the internet. But the idea that the information age is the natural successor to the industrial age is dangerously wrong. This is especially clear in that yuppie fantasy of the day, online investing. It is widely claimed that due to the proliferation of electronic and printed financial information, the individual investor now knows as much about what's going on in the markets as the professionals on Wall Street. Thanks to the internet, cell phones, and pagers, the average individual can follow the market as closely as the traders on a Wall Street investment bank. Everyone is now an insider. And if you believe that, I have a bridge for sale. Excuse me a second. Hello?
Yeah, John, listen, this is Bruce.
Yeah, okay.
John, it's Bruce. I've got a great deal. What's going on here? How come it's still ringing?
Excuse me, I'm new to this technology. I've got a pager that gives me the ticker. All right. Anyway, all right. Okay, yeah. No.
John, it's buy great. You got to buy it. It's done it all. Stock has gone up 100 points in the last 13 minutes just since they announced their Star Wars laxative program. It's great. It's going wonderfully. Now, I got an inside tip that Jerry Falwell is going to mention it on his program, and then it's going to flush like crazy. So we've got to be able to sell, but buy first. So you got to buy first.
All right, good. I still got some room on my credit card.
Okay.
So let's max it out.
All right.
Okay, good. I'm sorry, excuse me, that was my broker. Now, where were we? You know, the market's always moving, and if you don't stay on top of it, you can leave some money on the table. Now, much has been said recently about the dangers of day trading. Now, Harley suggested that I do a graph showing the relationship between the rise of day trading and the sales of automatic weapons. I didn't have time to pull that together, but I think you get the idea. That day trading is insane, certifiably insane. You have guys, mostly men, some women, sitting at computer terminals in freelance trading rooms, buying and selling stock like mad. Some of these geniuses make as many as 500 trades a day. They buy shares of a company, and then they sell them minutes, even seconds later. Most of them neither know nor care anything about the companies upon which they bet. All they care about is making money. In a typical day trade, the investor will buy a few thousand shares of a company, wait for the stock to go up 1/16 or 1/8 point, and then sell. Long term to a day trader means holding a position over lunch. Of course, the day trading terms, the companies that rent out these trading terminals to the individuals, often deliver lunch so that the traders can keep trading. This is a trick they learned from the casinos, which long ago figured that you do whatever it takes to keep the bettors at the table. Still, when the Wall Street investment banks and the Securities Exchange and Exchange Commission attack day trading as gambling, you'd better have plenty of salt on hand. Some argue day trading is really nothing more than speculation, Securities and Exchange Commission Chairman Arthur Levitt noted in a speech to the National Press Club in Washington on May the 4th. Personally, I don't think day traders are speculating, because traditional speculation requires some market knowledge. They are instead gambling, which doesn't. Now think about that one, traditional speculation. George Orwell would love that one. After all, day trading and online investing are merely the extension to the individual of the practices of Wall Street. Today, everybody's getting into the act, from grandma to the kids. There are now even summer camps where kids are taught how to play the markets. Suckers may not be born every minute, but they're certainly being trained. These markets are nothing but a giant casino. The gambling psychosis is so pronounced in the West that the recent World Congress of Psychiatry held a session on the matter. One professor said his clinic was filled with patients who had developed perfect gambling strategies. The only reason they believed they were in the clinic was because they hadn't fully yet mastered their own system. Other patients blamed their problem on bad luck. Former German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt put it more bluntly in a recent editorial, saying the Wall Street boom was based on the actions of psychopaths. Now, in a properly functioning economy, the most valuable industries would be those which make things, which transform less valuable inputs into more valuable outputs, thereby creating wealth and increasing the productivity of society as a whole. That's not exactly the way it works today. The most valuable corporation in the world today in terms of market capitalization is Microsoft, the first company in history to top $500 billion. The bugs in Windows must be worth $100 billion alone. Microsoft is worth more than the top five U.S. banks combined, which gives you a clue as to why the Justice Department is after them. The banks are terrified that should their dream of online trading ever take off, Microsoft would take over. Bill Gates is personally worth more than Chase Manhattan and J.P. Morgan combined. But then many of you are, too, were honest accounting employed. Even with the recent orchestrated declines, the internet stocks are astonishingly high. America Online is now one of the 25 largest companies in the United States in terms of market value, bigger than Ford and General Motors combined. Why? In part because of the foolish belief in the information society, and in part because our manufacturing base is collapsing, and because many people can't afford new cars. Fortunately, those who can afford a car to get to the store can always get their groceries through America Online over the internet. Yahoo, the internet portal and search engine, is comfortably in the top 100 in terms of market capitalization, nearly as big as General Motors, and nearly double the size of Caterpillar. Now, if you think that's nuts, and you're right if you do, take a look at eBay, the online flea market, where people auction off Beanie Babies, Pokemon, paraphernalia, and all sorts of odds and ends. Even though its computers have been crashing regularly, a real problem for an internet company, eBay is still valued at some $16 billion, making it almost twice as large in terms of market capitalization as the top five U.S. steelmakers combined. Pretty soon, you'll be able to buy the steel companies on eBay, assuming the computers are up. Now, there's been a lot of talk lately about the internet bubble, but calling the internet stocks the problem is a lot like pointing to a rock on top of Mount Everest and saying that that rock is a hazard to aviation. It's the mountain, not the rock, that's the problem. And in this case, the mountain is made up of derivatives and related financial instruments. The growth of the derivatives market is astonishing. According to the International Monetary Fund, world trade in goods totaled $6 trillion in 1998, and gross world product was $41 trillion. Compared to what we estimate was some $200 trillion in derivatives bets, and overall some $300 trillion in financial claims outstanding. There are more than $4 trillion in financial bets placed every business day. That puts annual financial turnover, the sum of all of these bets, at over one quadrillion, which is $1,000 trillion a year, which is some $150 to $200 in turnover for every dollar of trade in goods. It's clearly the internet stocks that's the problem. Now, the world derivatives figure is our own estimate. It's not entirely clear that anyone knows the actual number, and if they do, they're certainly trying to keep it a secret. All of the official figures are designed to hide rather than reveal the truth. The bankers call this transparency. Now, what are they doing with these derivatives? Hiding losses, rolling over unpayable debt. Look at Credit Suisse, which was just caught red-handed in Japan selling Japanese companies derivatives expressly designed to hide losses. One former Morgan Stanley derivatives salesman metaphorically described the process this way. You combine $90 worth of gold and $10 worth of lead into a bar. You then sell half the bar, the half which contains all of the gold, for $90. Now, since you paid $100 for the whole bar, and you sold half of it for $90, you have a $40 profit. After all, you paid $50 for that half pound on average, and you sold it for $90. So you made $40, right? Of course, you're left with a half pound of nearly worthless lead, which you're carrying on your books as being worth $50. But that can be hidden. What counts is that you made a big profit up front, or at least you claim you did. That type of fraud applied to paper assets is what the derivatives market is all about. This is the traditional speculation which SEC Chairman Levitt defends. Next graph. In the United States, the great economic boom of the 1980s and 1990s has been accomplished by going $3 in debt for every $1 increase in GDP. The top line, not surprisingly, is the debt. But since only one-third of GDP represents productivity and two-thirds represents overhead, and virtually all of the growth in GDP over the last decade has been in the overhead sector, we've actually been increasing the debt while shrinking the productive sector. This process of going ever deeper in debt while destroying our ability to pay that debt is what economists call sound economic fundamentals. The decline in the productive sector has triggered a decline in real wages for most Americans, next, who have been forced to go deeper and deeper into debt to make up for shortfalls in income. Total credit market debt in the United States now stands at over $23 trillion, or some $230,000 for every household in the country, compared to $10 trillion in debt and $115,000 per household when Alan Greenspan took over the Fed. Now, when debt rises and real income falls, bankruptcy can't be far behind, and it hasn't been. More than 1.4 million bankruptcy petitions were filed in 1998, of which 96% were personal bankruptcies. Over the last 7 years, 7.7 million personal bankruptcies have been filed. It's about one bankruptcy for every 13 households. Since Alan Greenspan took office, more than 11 million Americans have filed for personal bankruptcy, and nearly 700,000 businesses have failed. One of the linchpins of the assertion that the U.S. economy is fundamentally sound is the presumption that rises in asset values create wealth. That is, if the value of all stocks listed on the stock exchanges was $15 trillion yesterday and rises to $15.1 trillion today, then $100 billion worth of wealth has been created. By this standard, the U.S. stock markets are amazing wealth creation machines. When Alan Greenspan took over at the Fed, the capitalization of all stocks on U.S. markets was $3 trillion. Today, the stocks are worth $16 trillion, a fivefold increase. There's one small problem with this rosy picture, though. Stocks do not create wealth. In a speech last month at the Federal Reserve Conference in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, the chairman of the bubble, Greenspan, stated that, at root, I can't mumble like he does, but you can get the idea. At root, all asset values rest on perceptions of the future. A motor vehicle plant, assembly plant, is a pile of junk if no participants in the market economy perceive it to be capable of turning out cars and trucks of use to consumers and profit to producers. Now we're getting to the heart of the matter. A bubble has formed in Greenspan's brain. The idea that reality is determined by perception is one of the more pervasive idiocies of our time. The truth is that a plant which produces motor vehicles has value no matter what Wall Street thinks, and regardless of whether or not it makes a profit, because the production of motor vehicles is inherently useful. The plant can lose money and still be productive in real economic terms. It's the effect on the economy that counts, not the effect on investors. A steel plant, even the most outmoded, inefficient plant in the world, has more value than eBay because it produces steel, which is necessary for human survival. We can live without eBay, at least most of us, but we can't live without steel. But Wall Street lives by a simple philosophy. If it makes money for us, it's good. If it doesn't, it's bad. In such a warped worldview, full employment is bad because it increases the chances that companies will have to pay higher wages to attract and keep employees. For Wall Street, having a big pool of unemployed workers is good, since anyone who dares demand a decent wage or decent working conditions can be easily replaced. Therefore, when employment goes up, the market goes down. When employment goes down, the market goes up. The same thing occurs when the production indices, which should never be confused with actual production, when they go up. Rising production increases the chance that the economy will overheat from growing so fast, and thereby increasing the likelihood that the Fed will raise interest rates to cool things off. This is truly virtual reality. Those things which are good for society, such as a rising standard of living and rising productivity, are considered bad. And those things which are bad for society, like a declining standard of living and falling productivity, are considered good. All that counts to the fleas is their money. To hell with the dog. It is, in a word, psychotic. Sooner or later, such a system must inevitably collapse, and we have now reached that point. We have entered the zone of instability which marks the end of the present system. The party is over. Look at the pace of mergers in the financial world, where all of the big banks are in a mad dash to become too big to fail. After all, the big banks don't go bankrupt, they merge. In the trade, it's called mergers and acquisitions, or M&A. But to the families involved, it's a lot closer to S&M. Now, we have the formation of the world's first trillion-dollar bank in Japan, and a failed attempt to create a trillion-dollar bank in France. All over the world, the number of banks is shrinking rapidly as the drunks lean against each other in order to keep from falling down. In the U.S., the number of banks has dropped some 40% since the mid-1980s, but even that doesn't tell the whole story. The big banks are swallowing each other up at an incredible rate, usually in shotgun marriages arranged by the Fed. Now, as the bubble grew, a whole group of financial institutions grew up with it, institutions of seemingly great power. Now that the bubble is dying, those same institutions are threatened with extinction, and they're now fighting for their lives. They won't make it. These seemingly all-powerful giants are crumbling before our very eyes. But the more clever among the oligarchs have been preparing for the crash by buying up control over the necessities of life, so that after the crash, after all the paper wealth is evaporated and all the suckers have been ruined, they can control what is left of the world. That is the reason for the bloody wars along the Great Rift mineral belt in Africa, and the reason for the surge in mergers among industrial companies in recent years. There are those among the oligarchy who, after all, understand that those who control the raw materials, the strategic minerals, the precious metals, the energy, the water supplies, and the means of production and distribution of those items control the destiny of mankind. After the crash, they plan to use their control over these necessities of life to consolidate their control over humanity. This is what is behind the escalating pace of mergers in oil, food, telecommunications, pharmaceuticals, chemicals, aluminum, copper, energy, water utilities, and virtually every other field. The old system is gone, finished. The question is, what will replace it? A return to the days of the empire, or a leap into a new renaissance? To repeat the errors of the past is to doom the world to feudalism and a new dark age. Better that we learn from the best lessons of history and build that new renaissance. Let us choose reality over psychosis.
Thank you, John. You got your phone back? Okay. Okay. Your broker's on line one. Your credit card company's on line two. Your mortgage company's on line three. And the gun dealer's on line four.